So this is something that Europe cannot take into consideration, that they are creating people that they have, they lose their mental health, they lose their power, and what will happen with them? What will happen with these children? Who is going to answer why they are suffering? Because this is a big issue also. Why and for how long are we going to suffer? And why we are treated this way, this inhuman way? On the other hand, you have the fact that when you treat people in a dehumanizing them, the society and have the picture that these are not human. The people, the society next to them believes that they suffer because they are not human, and this creates racism and this creates fascism at the end of the day. Because if we tolerate these conditions for some people, it means that these people are not having the same rights as we have. They are not humans. I studied psychology, and actually all my career, professional life, was working in institutions. I worked in women's prisons, I worked with adolescents in the community, so, and a lot with psychiatric patients for the people that were moving to the community. So all my life, I think I was working with people that they were kind of marginalized, and they were the society was pushing them out. And in this situation under these choices that I made when I came to Lesbos, I moved to Lesbos to have a peaceful life away from Athens, to an island that was connected to migration and refugee for my family as well, because my grandmother passed as a refugee from Asia Minor. I started to try to understand that what is happening with refugees on the island, because actually it was a hidden reality. It was not visible. People were arriving in bigger and bigger numbers since 2001. And the people who were living here knew very little about them. We were listening in the news about illegal migrants who died, illegal migrants who were arrested, detained. We knew nothing. So in one point, because I had started to do a documentary and a radio also with a local radio station, I try to understand what happens with these people, why we don't know anything, and where they live, and how they die, and how come and don't know. And with other people, gradually we formed an activist group, very small one, very few people, they were really interested to this, and try to understand what happens to these people that they were living in detention, that all the rights were violated, and many of them, they had already died and they were buried in the local cemetery. So it was a matter of, understanding what happens next to us. It was not so much the work of a psychologist. It was mainly the social awareness of what happens next to me in this small island, and what happens to the land that I live, and I don't know what happens to the people next to me. So that brought me to this field, and from the beginning I started to be connected with other groups in Greece, with activists, with people in other countries, especially in Germany, that they were active. And we try to denounce the conditions, to talk about the human rights and about the life of the people that they, lives of people that they were lost in the border. We connected with activists in Turkey that they were facing similar problems. And many activists from all over Greece, and especially in the islands. And I learned a lot by the other people that they were already involved. And I think that what psychology helped me is that this human interaction that we needed to have with the people, to treat them as people, but we are talking about very basic things. You know, it was not about, you know, treating trauma or anything. It was just talking about the rights, talking to them and asking to be treated as humans. That was the basic thing. And also participating in groups that everybody was very fast in burnout and overwhelmed by this situation since many, many years. And then, of course, all my work on the field of how we talk about the dead people, how we treat the families of the dead people, it had to do with to give them the space and the dignity to mourn, to say goodbye to their loved ones, and to denounce that the fact that these people were lost for no reason. They were lost because they were hoping for a better life. And all these tragedies that they were hidden, and these people had no voice. They had no. They were not allowed even the ritual of a funeral. Because I'm involved since 2005 in refugee support work and solidarity movement, we had a lot of frustration and a lot of obstacles in our work all these years. All we had to deal with was a violation of the rights of the people, detention and exclusion of the society. So in 2012, when we had a number of people that started to arrive gradually to Lesbos, we had also the Greek financial crisis, the austerity measures in Greece, and the rise of Golden Dawn. The fascist party was in the parliament for the first time in Greece. That created a threat for all of us. So we started on the island to form a network of solidarity for all, for the Greek people as well, that they were affected by the crisis. And we, because of the experience we had for in refugee work and support, we started to talk about the rights of these people. And because all the refugees arriving on, in 2012 on the island, they were detained in police stations with deprived by all the rights, we, a big network of people, very open to the local society, we started to ask for an open, self-organized camp, an abandoned ex-camp for children, to use it as a human place, a decent place to host refugees, and the locals to support and to interact with them and take them out from the detention. So we started, Pikpa started as a dream, as an utopia, because even our activist friend, they told us this is impossible. In Greece, we never had a place without police and a place outside detention. Everything connected to refugees was detention. We insisted, we were many people involved, and in one point that there were refugees sleeping in the middle of the city, winter time in 2012 in November, the authorities gave us the keys to use Pikpa. And it was a summer camp for children, but abandoned for years. So we started, no budget story. People were coming, bringing food, clothes, interacting with the people. And it was like a miracle for us, actually, to involve the local society. That was already, there was a lot of hostility at this point. The people were saying, oh, why they are coming? But when they felt proud for being in solidarity, this changed a lot, the context on the island. That's how we started, and gradually, of course, when we went to 2015, that Pikpa couldn't host the thousands of people arriving every day, we focused on the most vulnerable. Pregnant women, children, handicapped people, women in danger. So we were focused on handicapped and many sick people and survivors of shipwrecks. The families that lost their beloved in the sea. So we were focusing on the most vulnerable, and we start also trying to organize our solidarity work. We were distributing food in the big camp, in the streets, medicines, connecting with other groups, supporting also still the locals that they were in need, trying to keep the balance in the society. And when we went to 2016, we have the announcement of the EU-Turkey deal, and thousands of people are trapped on the island. They couldn't go, they were staying, they were contained on the island to be sent back to Turkey as a safe country. So we start talking about creating an organization, Lesbo Solidarity, because before we were like individuals and volunteers supporting and a team, a group of people. And then we start talking about a legal entity so we can work, go deeper in services like psychosocial support, education for the people, integrational programs. And also we started to discussed and we, together with other groups like Borderline Europe, we created a support center in the center of Mytilene. That was also for education and activities, cultural activities, but for all the people. The idea was we, at this point, that we want a decent place, a place that we could go as well, and not the horrible place that for refugees. So it was also a kind of, you know, dream to create something in the middle of the city when people were starting already to be against refugees and the racism was increasing. And we never had problems in Mosaic because we try to keep it open to all and give also the message that this is a place, a cultural place, an integrational place, and this is for people to meet and work together. That was 2016. Pikpa had many from 2016, 2017, even 2015 and 18. We had eviction announcements from the local authorities and from the government. They didn't want the place. They wanted to close it down. There was a lot of reaction all over the world to support Pikpa, and every time, because it was much needed, the place, and it was a very good example. It was somehow an example in practice of what we have in mind. We want a decent place, and we made it. We don't just shout that we don't want detention. We make a place that is against detention, and it's happening. So we faced many, many threats, many, many evictions, and we fight it every year. Till the moment of 2019, when the authorities changing, we have a new mayor, a new governor of Lesbos, and a new government that is totally against, it's a massive attack against refugee rights. All the rhetoric is that refugees are a problem. We need to keep them out of our cities because people are afraid of them, although the problem was created by the, how we managed this situation, how we let people live in these camps. And these authorities were elected with a mission to decongest the island, to close every alternative facility and actually create closed or closed camps. Or camps where people will be having a restriction of movement and will not be visible. So the first thing that they announced was the closure of Pikpa. Although it was very difficult to close Pikpa because the need there was huge. The government, the local government was elected with 5,000 refugees in Moria, and in some months we had 22,000 of refugees. We had COVID. and COVID restrictions that affected mostly the refugees. So Pikpa was staying open, and we, instead of going back and saying, okay, we restrict our activities, we managed to create a safe space for unaccompanied minor mothers with their children, for very young minor children inside Pikpa, in collaboration with UNICEF. And we started a program to host more pregnant women, or women who gave birth in the hospital, or women in danger in the camp. And we created more space for them. And in this point, we have the fact that Moria was burned. There was a huge fire. This horrible place was destroyed. People were in the streets. The government created a new horrible place, a tent camp for 13,000 people. And with a lot of presence of police inside, not much services though. And at this point, they announced also, with the support of EU, of course, they announced the closure of Pikpa first in end of September 2020, and that they will close it at 15 of October. And then the closure of the old Karatepe, that was the other camp that was created in 2015 for vulnerable people. And although we fight it without all our forces and with the support of many refugee residents of Pikpa and many, many people all over the world, and the support in our campaign of many women refugees, that they were talking about Pikpa because they were the force of this campaign, we managed to fight back for 15th of October. They gave us some more days, and at the end they came with huge forces of the police. It was also a media game to present us as terrorists, which was like people that they were not going to confront the police in any case, and children, a lot of children. And they took the people to the old Karatepe, stating that this was decent conditions. And then, of course, when they closed it also, in April, they moved them to the new Moria, the Karatepe place. So that was it, and now we are still trying to, you know, to continue this dream of Pikpa, to talk about what we have done all these years as a living example, and to create, still we try to create decent accommodation. Now we managed to have a shelter for women with children, and we develop more shelter, which is very, very difficult. The political context is really a huge obstacle to all we are trying to do, but we are insisting because we believe that what we do is very much needed, and we cannot step back on this. It is an empty place now, an abandoned place. Again, as it was before we start Pikpa as a shelter for refugees. And I must tell you also that it was a heartbreaking process for us, because at this point, it was winter, people were suffering in tents and in the mud in the new camp. There were rapes of children. The situation was very, very bad, and we had to take out wooden houses and take out all our premises and dismantle Pikpa, because of, on top of everything, the local municipality, they came against us with a huge fine from the urban control, which was not concerning our work. It was concerning basically the ministry that is the owner of the Ministry of Labor of the place, but attacked us with a very severe way and blackmailing us that if we don't take everything out, we will have to pay a huge fine to the authorities. And this was also the tactic, and for me it's a criminal tactic, that they implemented also when the MSF, they created the first and the only isolation, medical isolation area for Moria in July 2020, and the urban police came and they gave them a fine for something that the authorities should have done, to create an isolation area for COVID cases and treatment, medical treatment for the people, and not put them in a tent and forget them and restrict them in a camp. So it is horrible what happened, and still we haven't processed all this, because, you know, the day that they closed Pikpa, the measures, the COVID measures started, and we couldn't even meet. We had to work in on Zoom, our team, to contact the people on WhatsApp. It was very, very difficult to process all this violence that we suffered. Look, the first thing that we have to talk about is the dehumanization of people. Under these conditions, people are not treated as people. And this has a huge impact on them. They are not only deprived of their rights, human rights, they are also deprived of their dignity. And they have no control of their life anymore in these conditions. They are just objects. So, for me, the most important thing is this loss of dignity and control of life. And the adversity is not always a bad, you know, when you are exposed to adversity, you are not becoming more vulnerable necessarily. But this, what happens to these people is that there is a lack of logic. That you cannot understand why this is happening to you. Why you got through all these adversities of a very dangerous trip and to Europe, and when you arrive, having risked your life, you are not treated as a human. People are always telling us, you know, is this Europe? Where are human rights? And, you know, I'm very tired of listening to this because I have no answer. Why are we treated as animals? Why? And of course people are having forces and they have power, but they lose it, because what is happening here is damaging people and humiliating them in every step. They stay in tents, they stay in queues waiting for everything to get a portion of food. They have to beg for every services. There is no information and there is no plan of their future. They cannot plan anything. And there are decisions taken in political level from EU, from the government, that they don't treat them as humans. They don't respect them. So anything we talk, I mean, there is nothing that is, if you talk about mental health, everything that is happening to these people is going against their mental health. We are not treating vulnerability. We are creating vulnerability. People get mentally and physically sick. Children have no access to school, have no access to a decent place. They have to get used to these, you know, horrible places that they are living in. And that no one from us could live there, and they live there. They live there without knowing when this will end. It's like torturing people, torturing for a long, long time. And this means that even if they go out of this in one point, if they go to Athens or if they go to Europe in one point, this will take them years to heal. How can you heal when you are suffering so long and in this way? So this is something that Europe cannot take into consideration, that they are creating people that they lose their mental health, they lose their power, and what will happen with them? What will happen with these children? Who is going to answer why they are suffering? Because this is a big issue also. Why and for how long are we going to suffer? And why we are treated this way, this inhuman way? On the other hand, you have the fact that when you treat people in a dehumanizing them, the society and have the picture that these are not human. The people, the society next to them believes that they suffer because they are not human, and this creates racism, and this creates fascism at the end of the day. Because if we tolerate these conditions for some people, means that these people are not having the same rights as we have. They are not humans. Otherwise, we cannot see this. We cannot accept this next to us. For the refugees, everything. I mean, everything that happens now is against the society, it's not only against humanity. At this point, solidarity on an island of solidarity, that we became proud of this, Lesbos was famous for solidarity, 2015. Now, solidarity is stigmatized. Human rights defenders solidarity people are stigmatized and criminalized. It's like a blame to say that, you know, he is a solidarity person. And this is happening with the participation of all the authorities. The main narrative in our media is this: refugees are the problem, they are criminals, and they are dangerous. We have to solve the problem. And at the same time, we are not talking about the criminal policies against these people and against all of us. Because if we don't realize that treating people as not humans, it affects all of us, it will affect our future. This is already a big mistake of Europe. They are treating Lesbos as a containment, an island prison. That people are staying here, so we prevent them of going to Europe, and we make them suffer in order not to come as a deterrence measure. So this suffering is like a deterrence policy. But this has no result. I mean, it's unacceptable anyway in all levels. I mean, moral level, political level, but at the same time, has no result. They don't understand this. They created inhuman places, and at the end of the day, the people need to come, and they will come. They will risk their life because they need to travel. They need safety, and we have to consider this: that migration and refugee issue is a very complicated situation. It's a human, very complex situation, but it's important for our society to deal with all our forces, with the participation of the society, not with the treating them as criminals and sending the police or the Coast Guard to keep them away with the pushback and Frontex. It's a human condition that we have to consider the society being involved and giving solutions, because it concerns us. It's not only about these people. So, I mean, this fortress Europe have no reason to exist, I believe, and damages the political situation in Europe. It doesn't damage only the life of so many people. I think that the main thing is to be aware of what is happening in the borders, and not to feel that we are in, it's not something that is happening far away. It, in a way, affects us all. We are here and we are suffering of these policies, but I think that the whole Europe is suffering from this. And Lesbos has become the last years a laboratory of inhuman policies as deterrent measures. We had camps all the time, detention places, all the prisons that they were used for detaining refugees. We have a shooting place now. The existing camp, it was a formal shooting place of the army, and now they are creating a new camp, as they call it, an invisible camp in the middle of nowhere, on a mountain next to a garbage place. We need to be aware of what is happening in the border, and we need to understand that, first of all, we need to stay connected, because what happens here concerns the whole Europe. It's not concerning only Greek or the people of the island. And at the same time, it's funded by you. it's paid by the citizens of what is happening here costs a lot. And nobody is talking about this. It's funded by EU. The Greek government cannot do anything without having the support of EU. And this is clear that the European citizens are paying for this. So we have to be aware and we have to react and to connect with the different places of Europe, that we are affected all by a crisis, yes, but the crisis is political. At this point, it's not a humanitarian crisis. There are political choices that make these people suffer in our borders and make our society hostile against them. So I believe that first we need to be aware and to react all over and to stay in solidarity with these people because it's critical for our future. We need to find new ways also to react because what we do so far, even if we denounce pushback, denounce the condition, has no result. It's like fighting a monster. The European policy and here is like a monster. And we have to find a way as citizens of this, of Europe, of a Europe that we believe that has to do with solidarity, not with safety in the way that is presented, that this is safety. So we need to find new ways to address these issues and we need to stay active. I'm not talking about funds because funds are spent here, people are collecting money. It's not only about financial support to the groups and them. It has to do also with active and new ways to mobilize people and to make this a problem of us and not a problem of the refugees. Because what we will face, it goes far beyond the refugees.